Hello everyone. Prime Minister Formalization of Micro Food Processing Enterprises PMFME scheme adopts one district, one product approach to reap the benefit of scale in the micro food processing sector. Under this, we, Niftam Thanjavur, are organizing a webinar on pulse processing and value addition.
We'll be moving ahead with our first technical session, which is on industry perspectives on pulse processing and value addition. For this technical session, we have with us Dr. Rajesh Kumar Vishwakarma, Principal Scientist, ICAR CIFIT, Ludhiana. So I will be providing us insights on the status of pulse milling processes and technologies. We welcome you, sir. The session is over to you.
I am very thankful to the Niftam Thanjavur. Its director and his team to give me an opportunity to share my views on pulse milling, pulse processing and milling aspects. Particularly, I am sharing one presentation. This was the study which we conducted in during past 2 years, which was funded by Department of Consumer Affairs. Particularly for the aspects of procurement, how the procurement should be made, what should be the norms and standards for storage, and how the milling should be done, and what should be the standards for those. So this was the study which we conducted during 2019-20. And you can say in the scenario of a COVID pandemic, we started our sampling in April 2020 and completed in March 2021. So the whole study was done in this during this period. The basic reason for this study was, we know that everybody is aware of how the pulses are used and processing is done, but we know that there is a shortage of pulse, and that is why we are importing the pulses. So the government of India decided in 2016, when the pulse prices went to very high, around 200 rupees a kg. So then they decided to create a buffer stock for the pulses, and the target was 4 million tons that should be procured or imported from other countries, and that buffer stock will be maintained. It has two advantages. Number one, the farmers who are growing pulses can be supported with the minimum support price, as well as other farmers will be encouraged to grow more, we can say, pulses for our country. So this was the reason. When after that they procured the pulses immediately within 2017, and then the problem of storage came, then problem of milling, how to dispose of those material, and what should be the quality standards for procurement, and other things came. So this study they gave us so that we can conduct and suggest the norms and the standards for procurement. So this was the main reason, and we know that these food grains can be stored safely with the, we can say, regular treatment with the fumigation and other aeration. But in case of pulses, it is very difficult to store, particularly when monsoon season comes and brook kits, which are the main culprit for losses in pulses, they attack severely in monsoon season and cause severe damage to the pulses. Even within 25 days, they can lose this infest the about 40% of grain in the pulses. Further, we know that Niftam Thanjavur has done a marvelous study on milling of pulses, black gram. I have seen the papers, research papers of scientists in the journals, and we usually refer those papers also. And then also PDKB Akola has also worked on milling. But the scenario was, what should be the milling outer, or we can say recovery from the pulses, when this is done at a large scale, particularly for the government bodies like NEFED and what the procuring agencies. And this standard should be on this scientifically designed study. One major problem is always comes when, particularly when storage is done, the moisture content is one of the important parameters, which always affects what should be the intake moisture, what should be the outgoing moisture, and how much quantity should be delivered at the time of liquidation. This problem is faced by Port Corporation of India, and we conducted one study for them also, and we suggested what should be the procurement moisture and what should be the delivery, we can say, handing over, when the stock is handed over, what quantity should be handed over when moisture increases or decreases. So this was also required for the pulses also, because these are biological materials and gain moisture or lose moisture depending upon the environmental conditions. Further, environmental conditions, we know that very different in different regions of country. At present, I am sitting at around 12 degrees Celsius temperature in Ludhiana, and Tanjore, our scientists are sitting at around 35-36 degrees Celsius environmental conditions. So we have a very large variation in environmental conditions. So this storage management practices become very location specific. Next one is, what Department of Consumer Affairs follows is the FSSAI quality standards for the whole pulses and all. Basically, these if we visit these standards, we will find that the FSSAI quality standards are for retailing of dal and pulses. These are not for procurement or for disposal of pulses. So, and these are based on mainly on admixture, foreign matter, infestation level, and moisture content. Other parameters, for example, if there is a patch on dal, husk patch on dal, its rate is reduced. If broken percentage is more, its rate is reduced. If cotyledons are scored during milling, rates certainly changes for the dals. So these are the things which has to be considered by the FSSAI. And we found in this study what should be the these parameters which should be considered by FSSAI to prepare the norms or standards for marketing as well as procurement of the pulses. We know highly efficient processing machines and processes also cannot improve quality. So that is why procurement, when we talk about large scale procurement by government agencies, so there must be a norm, what should be the foreign matter, what should be admixture, and all those things, so that we can prepare the norms. Based on these things, we prepared this project to develop a pulse and dal storage management practices norms, and to evaluate the effect of storage condition on shelf life, milling out and ratio, and on quality, and to articulate standards for milling out and their relation with the storage, and to identify indicative norms for procurement and buffer stock management. So involved total 8 institutions in this study. NEFED was one of the agencies, because NEFED is the agency who procures the pulses. A small quantity of pulses is also procured by Port Corporation of India and is stored in Central Warehousing Corporation, Godown. Some of the state warehousing corporations also store these pulses. Basically, most of the godowns are warehouses of state where housing corporations are used for the stock management, but NEFED is the manager. So that is why we took the help of NEFED, provide the facilities. We selected 5 pulses, pigeon pea, chickpea, black gram, green gram, and lentil, and warehouse storage was done. Warehouse was selected, and this study was conducted up to 20 months. In laboratory study, we stored the pulses in laboratory conditions. Green gram was done at Ludhiana, lentil was stored at IIPR Kanpur, pigeon pea at Raichur, chickpea at Akola, and black gram at Rudaipur. And bag storage was done. It was freshly harvested grain, and dal was also stored. Its quality analysis was done after 3, 6, 9, and 12 months. The dal was stored at 10, 12, and 14% standard moisture contents, whereas pulses were stored as which was taken from the market. So I'm coming to the results. We collected total 459 samples of 20 kg pulses and from the different godowns located in different states covering Maharashtra, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Karnataka, and Andhra also. One of the most important things which we observed that insect infestation was not observed when the pulses were stored in laboratory conditions during winter and summer season. But whenever there was a rain, or we can say this relative humidity was more than 65% or 70%, and it prevailed for more than 5 days. Even in winter also, the insect infestation was observed. Treatment with phosphine controlled infestation, but insect attack, this was brookid mainly, attack was observed again within 15 days of humidity. So, if we talk about foreign matters, was 1 to 2% in most of the samples collected from different warehouses. And weevil grains were found in majority of the pulses. So the losses were very less than 1%. And the dals, which were stored at 14% moisture content, whatever it was, whether it was lentil or whether it was pigeon pea or chickpea, it was safe up to 2 months of the storage only. After 2 months, lump formation took place and fungal growth was observed. Whereas FSSAI recommends that the dal can be marketed up to 14% moisture content. So they should recommend, they should change this moisture content standard and come to around 12%. One of the important findings of this study was the godowns which were located in Rajasthan, particularly in the western Rajasthan, we can say the semi-arid and arid region of Rajasthan. And there green gram and chickpea was stored. So no insect infestation was observed even in the monsoon season, we can say during July and October, July to October months also. So this is the region, we can say, that's a semi-arid and arid region of Rajasthan may be developed as a hub for storage of pulses, whole grains, whole pulses in that region, and thereafter we can transport it to the other places for milling and converting into the dal and other value-added products. So this was particularly the godowns in which storage was done. And this was the way by which we process, conducted the milling operations and defined the milling outer and outer ratios. The scenario is, if we take other than food grains, in most of the samples which were collected from the warehouses in Madhya Pradesh, in chickpea, highest foreign matter was observed. In pigeon pea, it was Karnataka, where highest foreign matter was observed. In green gram, Maharashtra has the highest foreign matter. And in black gram, Rajasthan had maximum percentage of foreign matter. And in lentil, because lentil is basically procured in only two states, Madhya Pradesh and southern part of Uttar Pradesh. So there, this was the scenario. Admixture, particularly food grains, if we talk, we can see that in chickpea in Madhya Pradesh, 0.46% admixture with other food grains was observed. There were places where very clean grain was also observed, particularly black gram in Madhya Pradesh. There was no admixture with other food grains. Wheat grains were there everywhere. And if we see the Karnataka, I had maximum wheat grains, particularly in pigeon pea, and this was brookets. These were brookets mainly. In Maharashtra also, in most of the chickpea, pigeon pea, as well as in black gram, wheat grains were observed, particularly when this storage was done in the warehouses. So this was the scenario. Mechanically damaged grains, you can see that this is the scenario. When we talk about mechanically damaged grains, we conducted two studies on post-harvest assessment of harvest and post-harvest losses in CFET. One was conducted during 2005-2009 and another was conducted during 2012-2014. And that was the observation that the farmers are threshing the chickpea as well as black gram and other these pulses using high capacity threshers. So those threshers were damaging the grains to a very large quantity. We can say that around 5 to 6% grains were usually damaged in those threshers. And when any grain is damaged mechanically, when we will go for milling, the losses will be very high. So this was the scenario in 2014-15 also, and even that scenario is prevailing today also. So the issue is how can we develop a proper thresher for these pulses, so that, and high capacity also, because the farmer don't want to keep the material for longer. He wants that once harvesting is done, immediately threshing and can be done, and grain can be goes to the storage of its godown or its premises. So this is the scenario, and there is a very important need of good quality thresher for these pulses. The threshers which are used for wheat are not suitable for these pulses, pulse threshing. So when we take a complete unwanted material, we can see that this unwanted material may go up to 4.9 or 5%, particularly in Rajasthan. In Maharashtra, the scenario, because this NAFED procurement of pulses is mainly focused in Maharashtra. So they are procuring more pulses in Maharashtra, and the second comes Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh. So if we see that the total unwanted material which is coming is very high in some of the states. So that needs, we can say, a norm for procurement. So this is the scenario. When we talk about milling, the 1000 grain weight comes and based on that 1000 grain weight only we can decide the size also. So if we see the variation, what is the variations in samples which we are observed in chickpea, in Andhra Pradesh we found almost similar size of the grains. That is why this 1000 grain weight was not varying much. But if we see the same scenario in Madhya Pradesh, the size of chickpea is varying from this 1000 grain weight is varying from 129 to 297 grams. So this is a wide variation. It means size is very small to very large. Similar is the case in Rajasthan also, in Maharashtra also. Further in pigeon pea, again the same scenario was there in green gram because it was mainly found in Rajasthan. So there also there is a wide variation from 28 gram to 56 gram. So this is the scenario when we take the milling at a larger scale, particularly in the industries. So such kind of variations in grain sizes as well as 1000 grain weight is going to affect our milling outer recovery to a very large extent, because in most of the dal mills which we are using in commercial scale as well as which were developed by different organizations can handle only one size of the grains. This, if this type of variation is there, it is very difficult that we will get a better recovery in such cases. In case of milling outer, basically this milling outer for this deciding the milling outer, we conducted several studies and the processes which were developed by NIFTM Tanjore and PDK via Cola and other organizations. We took all those processes into account and then we prepared one standard for milling of the pulses, and we used this PDK with all mill for deciding the milling outer. And the same machine was used at every place. So this was the scenario. In chickpea, we can get 75.49% recovery when it is fresh. And in general, the recovery increased with increase in storage period. So IIPR director sir was telling that this gums between husk and cotyledon, which is present, it creates a problem, or we can say binds the both together, and that is why it has to be loosened for milling. But this storage is also one of the factors which loosens this bond. If the grain is stored at 10 or 12% moisture content and the storage period is prolonged, then this bond between hull and cotyledon is loosened to some extent, and that is why recovery is more. But there is a negative aspect of this also. When this storage is done, particularly in pulses, and if in monsoon season or in rainy season this brocade attack comes, then it will affect the milling outer in a very negative way, and it will this outer may be reduced to a very large extent. So this was observed in some of the cases. That is why if you see the green gram, this milling outer or outer ratio increased because there was no infestation in the samples which were taken from the Rajasthan, and that is why this recovery was very high. Lentil is one of the easiest grain to pulse to mill, because just you dry it to a 10% moisture content and feed in any mill and dehull the material very easily. A grade 1 recovery. Here grade 1 dal and grade 2 dal, everybody knows that it is well defined. that when this whole dehulled pulses are split into two hops, then it is called grade 1 dal, and it is not polished. So that grade 1 dal recovery was, sorry, this is wrong figure is given, it is around 30% in case of PSNP, and in case of chickpea it was around 29 to 37%. Milling loss, when we talk about any of the this pulse milling machine, whether it is PDKB dal mill, whether it is commercial dal mill, or whether it is dal mill developed by any other agency, even IIPR Kanpur or CIGI Bhopal, all the mills, if we take into account the milling losses when it is milled, though it is reduced, it reduces with the storage period to some extent, but it is quite high. In case of chickpea, it is around 10%. In case of peasant pea, it varies between 14 to 19% or 20% even. And in case of green gram, also it is around 7 to 12%. In black gram also, it is 9 to 18%. And in case of lentil, it is very less, but it is around 4.4 to 7%. So this is the scenario. Whatever machine we are using, this much losses will be observed when milling is done. This is the material which is converted into brokens and powder during milling operation. So this is the material which we can use, particularly if we want to develop any value added product or reconstituted dal, or using it for other things like want to isolate the protein or anything else. So this is the valuable material which we are losing. Though there is a negative aspect of this also. If this material is goes for value addition for human consumption, then what will happen to the animals, particularly cattle? Because all this material goes to the cattle feed also. So we have to see that that area will not also suffer, and we can utilize it for human consumption and value addition also. So OTR, which we conducted in milling this under laboratory conditions, in case of chickpea it was around 75%. Black gram also 75%, in green gram it was 79%, in pigeon pea it was around 74%, and lentil up to 80%. As I told that when dal was stored at 14% moisture content in laboratory, it was safe up to 2 months only. So this moisture level of 14% is not recommended for storage of dal. And this FSSAI standard should be relooked, but again in this light. What we recommended that for procurement, this pulses should be procured at 12% moisture content or less, because this procurement is at present the level is 14% for chickpea, and for others it is around 13%. So it should be 12% uniformly for all the pulses. Stacking can be done up to 16 bag height. If it, we are going above 16 bags or 3 meters, there it was observed that the pulses which are at the bottom were damaged. So if damaged, then recovery will be there. Attack of pulse beetles was observed when humid condition was prevailed for more than 4 to 5 days. So, and what happened when this fumigation with the phosphine, aluminium phosphide was done, the briquettes flied away, and after 3 or 4 days of completion of the fumigation, again they came back. So this was the scenario. So when this monsoon season or humid season is prevailing for more than 4 or 5 days, the this sampling should be done regularly within a week. And it should be taken care by fumigation or by other treatment. Here, because it is quite difficult to take the samples at every week from the stacks, so there should be a mechanism which should be developed for this purpose, so that we can identify that this pulse beetle attack or brocade attack has come, and any other treatment for safe storage of pulses should also be developed, because fumigation means we are going to stop the whole activity in a warehouse for 7 days, because it is done in airtight condition and nobody is allowed to enter in the warehouse when this fumigation is started with aluminium phosphate. So we have to go for any alternate method for disinfestation treatment, which should be in which this aluminium phosphide or such harmful gases are not going to be. But in present conditions, 9 gram per ton pulse, 7 days exposure in airtight conditions was very effective in controlling the pulse beetles and other insects. But the scenario is that after removing this, the insect attack will come again. What we recommended, this unwanted material, including foreign matter, whatever other grains are there, mechanically damaged grains, it should be less than 2%. Initially, when fresh grain is procured, there should not be any infestation in the grain. If we are going to initial infestation means insect, adult insects should not be present, because we cannot disinfest the grains, because eggs will always be present from the field, and it cannot be visualized by naked eye also, or using a smell instrument, but insect eggs are always present. So we can say that adult insect infestation should not be there, and there should not be any tolerance for such. Grain size, there must be one standard, because when we talk about milling, uniform size of the grain is very important. So if the government or any other agency wants to procure, they can procure small size, medium size or large size, is no problem, but that should be stored separately, so that it should not be mixed. Otherwise, when it goes for the milling, it becomes very difficult for to the millers to handle such grains. Moisture content must be less than 11%, and there is this recommendation of high quality moisture meters. I urge everyone listening in this webinar, because we have the moisture meters which are based on dielectric constant, and what we found in this Food Corporation of India storage study also, and in this study also, they are showing 2% more moisture, around 1 to 2% more moisture in comparison to the laboratory condition or hot air, standard hot air oven methods. So because these were based on these instruments were based on samples which were taken 20 years, 25 years back, and those parameters were used in that instruments. Those are obsolete, because varieties have changed. We can say the hardness and other parameters of the grains have changed. So those parameters are not valid in present scenario, and those moisture meters are not good. So we should develop high quality moisture meters, maybe an IR or maybe any other technology, because Food Corporation of India and other agencies want such quality moisture meters which can measure the moisture of different grains in a precise manner. For storage, we recommended that initial fumigation should be done immediately after the storage, and sampling time should be at 15 days when normal environmental conditions are prevailing, and it should be around 7 days when relative humidity is more than 65% or more than 5 consecutive days. 10 sampling should be done immediately after 7 days, and storage moisture should be less than 12%. And fumigant all the stacks in a godown at a time. Because this was observed when in one warehouse, the pulse was stored, green gram was stored at one place, in one stack, and in the next stack, they stored groundnut. So what happened? Brookid attack came into the groundnut, and then those insects infested the grain. So in such a case, such type of practice should not be adopted whenever we are going to store pulses at large scale. These pulses should be stored in a separate chamber, and other grains are particularly when we talk about groundnut, it should be stored in a separate chamber. These should not be mingled together or stored nearby. For milling, what was our observation? No miller wants infested grain. If the infested grain is given to them, they immediately refuse to mill that pulse, because high broken and high powder formation takes place once infestation takes place. And we recommended uniform one is our milling outer, or we can say recovery from the whole pulses for only. And milling washer content, we know that it is less than 10%, but it should be more than 8%. So for all the pulses, the milling is.
Excuse me, sir. Yes. Sir, sorry for the interruption. Sir, can you please make it little bit fast?
Final. This is the final slide.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Future studies, which are very much required, we are not storing pulses in silos. Number one, and all storage also can be done into the silos. These studies should be done. Standards for storage of oil seeds are not available. Milling technologies, because I gave anything about this milling technologies, because everybody knows that was the kind of machineries which are available, and implementation guidance should be given by the institutes like NEFTEM, like CFED, CIA, for the implementation of such programs, recommendations in the field, particularly if we talk about Consumer Affairs, Department of Consumer Affairs, NEFED, and other agencies who are storing. IoT and artificial intelligence based storage, material handling, and inventory monitoring models must be developed so that we can monitor all these things from in a precise manner, so that losses will be reduced. So thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such an informative session. Moving ahead to the next technical talk, we have with us Ms. Tonisha Dixit, consultant, PMFMU NEFTEM Thanjavur, who will provide us insights on the PMFME scheme guidelines and features. We welcome you, ma'am. This session is over to you.
Thank you. So, the scheme stands for Pradhan Mantri Scheme for Formalization of Micro Food Processing Enterprises. And this scheme aims at providing support to beneficiaries, which are basically micro food processing enterprises, self-help groups, and farmers producers organizations. So this objectives of this scheme is providing increased access to credit by the existing already in business micro food processing enterprises, groups like farmer producer organizations, self-help groups, and cooperatives. And further, being the promoted by Ministry of Food Processing Industries, it aims at providing professional and technical support and awareness and access for the enterprises. It further aims at strengthening the institutions also at state level and district level so that they can furthermore contribute towards the training and research in this sector. Then it further aims at supporting the entrepreneurs by providing increased access of common services like processing services, packaging, laboratory, testing, storage, marketing. So these are the services wherein the entrepreneurs generally require support and the various accessibility to centers like incubation centers. So that also being promoted under the scheme. And the scheme aims at providing support to transition of existing 2 lakh enterprises into a farming framework. So the earmarking of funds of the scheme is involved. And here you can see the regional outlay, like to the states. So 50% is, 60% is from state central government, and state have to contribute 40%. And the basic total outlay of the scheme is 10,000 crore for a period of 5 years, starting from 2022-2025. So basic benefits, we can say financial benefits to the beneficiaries is that it will help in accreditation of the already existing micro units. And that will be through credit linked subsidy at the rate of 35%. And the maximum capping is of 10 lakh rupees. So 45% of the total project cost will be held through a credit subsidy. Same is that in the case of the groups as well. Additional support is there in terms of providing seed grant, working capital support, seed capital support in terms of 40,000 rupees to the SHU members. Further financial support is being provided to the establishment of common innovation facilities at various state and private establishments, institutions. And for that also, so for government institutions, 100% support is being provided, and for private, 50% support is provided for establishment of common processing lines. And based on all the things, I'll take that in coming slides. So basically, as I was mentioning, this scheme follows one district, one product approach, wherein all the districts have been earmarked one product when in the food processing sector commodities. So these are being finalized in discussion with the states, what they feel based on the market requirements, based on the trends of enterprises already existing in that product, and so they might be requiring support for further strengthening and organizing their enterprises. So those are such approaches. The ODOPs has been identified for each of the district, and they have been approved by the ministry. So these ODOPs basically constitute of various agricultural produce like green foods and vegetables, then various primary processed foods out of these food products, and then the traditional Indian products also. It also comprises of the subsectors of fisheries, poultry, meat processing. And so there have been several districts that have been looking at different products are required. So there had been approvals at the time. So this basically shows the ODOP cluster in that particular district, which can be further strengthened. That is the aim of the scheme. And that can further be expanded to the adjacent districts also. And it will also help to further strengthen the cluster by providing the common incubation facilities with those ODOP processing lines also in that particular districts, and marketing and branding supports also. So this is the administrative architecture of the scheme, wherein at the national level, there is this IMEC committee, which takes care of all the final approvals, and at the state level, the committee chaired by Chief Secretary is taking care of the state level decisions and project expenditure up to the 10 lakhs. District level committee is the key playing the key role of supporting and forwarding the applications, and taking care of all the beneficiary handholding support under the chairmanship of the collector. And on the district level, governance has been taken care by the district level administration. And the approval, so it involves approval of applications for be it from individual applicants or groups for loan and subsidy. And then they'll find further recommendation allocating the district resource person to these applicants for further support and ensuring the smooth submission and smooth selection with the relevant district level bodies. So basically, how to apply. So this part will concern you most, as most of you might be interested in applying for the scheme. So for the individual units, individual micro food processing enterprises, they can apply on the website through online portal. We'll show you shortly the online portal also of the ministry, wherein you can apply the application. And for the groups like farmer producer organization, self-help groups, cooperatives, the application is an offline mode, wherein all the formats have been provided on the website. You can download, you can check what are your documents to be filled in and then applied. That also I will show you shortly. And that has to be submitted to the state nodal agency. And for the marketing and branding, so state has to propose the, so for example, there are certain products having say GI tags or having, are required to have some local awareness of branding. So that proposals are required to be submitted in consultation with the relevant associations to the ministry, and that can be put up, and the relevant enterprises also can reach out to the state nodal agencies if some certain brands are there which are required to be identified or which are required to be promoted. So this can be further processed by the state nodal agency applications. So basically, this scheme is composed of various components, starting from the capacity building component of it. It ensures providing training to various stakeholders of the scheme. So basically, the trainings are involved. So there are two types of basic trainings. One is the product-specific training, and another is the entrepreneurship-related training. So product-specific training is actually divided into these food subsectors. These are the domains wherein the trainings are provided. And it involves providing knowledge on basics of machinery, costing, food handling, packaging, product quality, safety. And for the entrepreneurship development, the trainings are conducted for providing the knowledge on functional aspects of business, and details about the preparation of DPR and procedures, and setting up enterprises, or formalization, how to do it. So basically, quality standards and hygiene and regulations, all these things are concerned in that. So most of the trainings under this scheme are covered in online mode. And so these are the various beneficiaries, we can say, of the stakeholders who are being provided the trainings. Starting from the core beneficiaries of the scheme, that is individual micro food processing enterprises who are interested in getting the crediting subsidy, or those who are not interested in getting the crediting subsidy, both are being provided the training. Then workers of such establishments, micro food processing enterprises, then the groups that we that are already existing and into, and they are working in food processing in our sector. So members of those groups, then government officials and other stakeholders who are involved in functioning of the scheme, and the resource person who have been appointed by the departments to support these applicants in preparing the DPR and all those things. So as I was talking, the first level of training is being provided through the master level training that is being provided at the national level. So Mr. Panjawar has been conducting the domain-specific training in coordination with various national level institutes. And we have been instrumental in coordination of all these trainings. And till now, we have been training more than 300 master trainers in all the, including all the various subdomains. So the level of trainings involved after the master trainers, these trainers are required to be qualified, and the assessment is conducted by FUC, that is the Sector School Council for Food Processing Sector under MSD. So once they are qualified, they have the responsibility, or they have the they have to take up the trainings of the district level trainers. So basically from here, the role of state nodal agency starts. The state nodal agency nominates the district level trainers from their already existing designated institutions, like technical institutions they already have, or some state level institutions like universities or institutions or KVKs. And these trainers are nominated by them. And then these master trainers provide the training to these trainers. So basically, the function of training of trainers or the district level trainers is to provide the training to the ultimate beneficiaries. So the training at this level is provided at the OBO device, product wise, basically. So here the focus is on covering major aspects of the product training, like value addition in the product, what are the machineries that are used in that, what are the key packaging techniques and the issues faced and how to deal with them. So basically, more focus is provided here on the district level product that is being promoted, so that the entrepreneurs will, and the trainers and the entrepreneurs will have a more awareness and more, they are more equipped about the product specific details. So these district level trainers are also being then have to undergo assessment, and once they are qualified, they will be ready to train the beneficiary level training. So beneficiary level training can happen in physical mode for a better clarity, and it involves demonstrating various equipments also in the shop floor. And this has been taken care by the state level and district level technical institutes. So basically, these district level trainers, they are either for the technical domain, they are either having a basic degree and in food technology, engineering, or science and allied areas, and they're having a minimum experience of 2 years. So they are well suited with the basic knowledge of the food subsector, and they are being focused, they are being provided with the focus training. So basically, they are the first time trainers, they will be providing an extensive training of 64 hours, and they are already been providing trainings, so then they are provided only with the 16 hours of ODOP training. For the EDP, they are the designated district level training institute trainers, and they are also undergoing the district level training. And these are the beneficiaries, which are such training has been provided to the beneficiaries who are existing entrepreneurs. They have been providing 50 hours of training, and the new entrepreneurs are available 50 hours classroom and 10 hours of online. So now comes the another part of the scheme, that is Common Incubation Facility, which aims at providing the support of establishment of processing facility for OTOP and NIT products. So it basically aims at running the established incubation facility on commercial basis. That is the key aim, so that to make it sustainable. And to, further, it aids in the scheme by providing a platform within the beneficiaries can also be trained and can be given an awareness and demonstration to the equipments of those particular products. And so these are the components that are being covered involving. So basically, an incubation center can have processing lines based on ODOP. And then parallelly, they can have another 2-3 light product lines based on the nearby district's coverage and what is the key product that is being processed in the nearby districts. And then they shall be running on the commercial basis. So this is the application procedure. Application is an online mode only. All the government and private institutions can apply for being the incubation centers. And this is the online application wherein they will have to provide all the proposed details about the incubation center. And it will further be recommended by the, it has to be recommended by the state level agencies, state level technical institute, and it will be recommended by the state level committee. And then it will be submitted to the ministry, and once that is done, then it will be scrutinized by the various committees, and then it will be further recommended for the establishment. So till now, we have 64 incubation centers approved in various terms. And these are the various modules that I was talking about. I'll quickly take you through the website wherein you can have further details about various. So basically, when you are going to the institute website, you have this PM Economy Scheme dedicated portal for the same. And for that, we are having, so here you can see we have trained in now more 25 master trainers, and the student level trainers are being trained by states. And here are the, so these are the incubation centers, 64 have been approved in now. And the ODOPs that are approved, so we have been preparing training materials for all the ODOPs. So as you can see, like today we are talking about pulse processing. So power making, we have all the material available with us. And we are trying to convert it into other languages also. And we are asking for the states also to have translation to this. So basically, for each and every product, we are preparing processing presentation, then entire industry level demonstration video, then how to do the packaging in detail, various options available, then food safety and standards for various products. So related to that particular product, then modern VPR and post material involving. So I will just show you one demonstration video. So like this, paper making video we are putting up, from dough making to how to do, this is pure demonstration, one can have a look. So basic equipments you will be able to get an awareness about. Similarly, we have all my presentation faculty biology and just have to submit the basic details, and you can have the contains all the details like flowchart, manufacturing process, what are the equipments involved. So you will have a clarity on, depending on the scale of manufacturing, you can decide on the process and the equipments, and what are the factors, which packaging material is required to be used, and necessary standards, hygiene, and everything. So this is the entire handbook. So like this, all these modules we have prepared for all the subdomains. If you're interested in some other products also, so you can just check it out. So all the domain-wise products are listed here. Now we are trying to cover one another products also of these particular ODOPs. So basically, these are ODOP devices. And similarly, we have already been providing the capacity building training materials also. So that also you can refer here. All the training materials have been provided, and the domain-specific training materials are also being there. So if you are looking for some detailed, coverage of some particular domains, for example, grain processing, so you can check the handbook also. It tries to cover majority of the things in here. And so like this, we have created the portal for the capacity building handbook and additional training. So, and now I will just show you the industry website that involves. So here you can see the online applications are invited, wherein this is for the individual enterprises, and we can just select the individual application, and then you will have to first sign up. That will give you one user ID, and you can set the password, and then you can simply log in. So this is the site for seeing all the contact details of state nodal points, district nodal points, and district resource person. Everything is implemented in here. Which, if you want to contact anybody, if you're facing any issues and technical issues or API-related issues, you can definitely get a list from here. And that you can contact. And this is so all the scheme guidelines and everything. I'll just have a look at you. And further, I was telling about the offline application for the groups, self-help groups and farmer producer organizations. So that also is available. Yeah, you can see offline application forms for groups. So here, for it. So it will show you for cooperatives, farmer producer organization, SLGs also, all the guideline application form, standard structure of DPR, and all these things you can refer to. It will help you with compiling the information that is required for your business. And these are the business guidelines. So, you can definitely check here. So that's all from my side. I hope you have gained insights about the scheme and it'll be helpful to you, and looking forward to your participation in the same. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. May I now invite Dr. R. Jaganmohan, Professor and Head, Product Development, NIPTEM Thanjavur. Now, sir will provide us insights on processing and value addition of pulses. We welcome you, sir. The session is over to you.
Thank you. So, I welcome you all for this Pulse ODOP program. And I hope we have given a little attention to all these pulses. And we are the major producers and consumers of pulses. And little has been given consideration on improving the pulses processing, and many of the things are there. Still, we are way behind in processing the pulses. So, this is the institute, our institute. And why we want to have the pulses? So, in Indian scenario, if you see, the pulses plays a major role in supplementation of the protein for the population. And at an average, we are taking around 26 grams of protein per day. And through that, protein supplementation is only around 6.9 grams. So we have to improve upon this consumption, pulse consumption, and alternate proteins also we have to see. And there are a lot of opportunities in the pulse industries. And how much is the quality? When you see the quality of the protein, it is it's been explored in many ways. One for the protein and another for the starch from oligosaccharides present in the pulses are very excellent sources for the probiotic and prebiotic foods, which can be developed in many ways. Non-starchy polysaccharides, these are all excellent qualities of the pulses, and many of the things we are yet to utilize our full potential of the pulses. So production wise, we are number one throughout the world. We are number one, but we are also consuming equally. So around we have around 23 million tons of production up to date. So what is pulse processing? Actually, if you see pulse processing, if you say the paddy, it is converting into rice, either parboiled or raw rice, and millets, it is grain flour. We are using only the maximum flour making, and then pulses, it is converting into dal, and oil seeds into extracting the oils. So these are the major things. And what are the three components we are working on is dry grinding or wet flour, and soaking and grinding, and fermented products. So pulses are major consumed in this format. And what is the current utilization part? When you see how we are utilizing the pulses, whole legumes, like slightly directly cooked legumes, like peas, half gram, green gram, cowpea, and some of the things are dehulled. And dehulling is mainly done for the red gram, black gram, and green gram, and minimum for the dangal gram. And if you see that parched and puffing, major things, roasted dangal gram we are using, and partially it is being germinated and cooked in the raw form. And further, the dehusked split pulses are consumed in different forms, like cooking, whole cooking, and for sambar, or many other culinary components are made from this tuvar dal and black gram. And we see legume powders, we are using a lot of legume powders, and a lot of snack foods are being produced based on the pulses. So Indian scenario, when you see that pulse processing in all over the India, there is certain list of equipments which we are using, like emery rollers, rail sieves, and water mixing, polisher, dehusker, vertical plate and burn mill, and horizontal chakki, vertical chakki, then size grading aspirators. All these things are the equipments commonly used on the mills, pulse mills. So what is the processing, general schematic processing of pulses is, the whole raw pulse is cleaned, grade as per the earlier Vishwakarma has given that clear ideas about cleaning and grading and storing aspect. And then pitting, it is one of the action where it scratches the surface of the grains, so that the next process is mixing with the oil. So when the oil is mixed, the oil is penetrating into the husk and the grain. So there is an it creates a gap. It penetrates into that and it creates a gap in that, and then we are sun drying it. So drying helps in improving or separating the husk and using the removing the husk from the cotyledons. So and after that, when we are using the sun drying and heaping it, and we add some water so that it gets easily separated out, because the water absorption characteristics of the grain is different and the husk is different. So once that water is added, the grains get little bit enlarged so that it loosens the husk further. So it facilitates the removal of the dehulling of the pulses. So when we get the different forms, different categories of different parameters, or the husk powder, husk and split husk and all broken and whole husk and unhusked grains together come here. So here sometimes we are using an color sorting for removing the dehusked and old unhusked pulses. Only technology that has been done, and then split husk dal is subjected to polishing through water and then back. So these are the conditions what we have, overall scenario of the pulses general thing. So what are the machineries we are using is the emery rollers. The emery roller, there are two types of emery rollers. One is complete parallel emery rollers, and then certain things are little bit horizontal, cylindrical, little bit of horizontal thing, so that the pressure or the milling things here, they use this little bit rough surface of emery grits are there, which will facilitate in pitting. And this one is for the second one is for the polishing the grains. So inside this, before coating with the emery coat, what are the type of hullers will be there? Emery rollers are there. So you can see this, small nails are impregnated in the wooden frame, and then emery coating is done. So now this technology has been evolved in many things. We have ready, we have vertical polishes, different types of polishes have come in, and hulling units have been developed. So this is the overall scenario of the pulse milling industries. After the pitting and thing, we are subjecting the pulses for oil mixing, using an oil mixer, emery oil mixing, and then this is subjected to drying. So this is the inside the oil mixing auger, they call it as auger in general terms, that oil is or added in a ratio of say around 2% level, and different edible oils are used, right, from the palm oil to very costly oils also used, but this is to facilitate or mix the grains with the oil and at particular rate. So dosing units are kept for this one, and after that they are subjecting it for drying. So drying is of different types. They use a wooden wood fired stoves, gas fired furnaces, and electrical type of thing like this. And then they used to, once again, that after drying and conditioning, they go for the polishing. Okay, so these are the drying systems. The pulses are given conditioning and then they go for further processing. So the current practice of pulse milling is it takes 2 to 3 days for complete processing. First they go grade it, clean it, and then go for the pitting and oil application, and then once again it is being separated for slight milling and more energy. It has been more energy and more cost, and then the yield is lesser. So these are the some of the drawbacks in the current practices. So we have come up with certain process where a little bit of hydrothermal treatment is given, and there is no need for pitting and no oil application, but single pass with an vertical polishing equipment and lesser energy and lesser time consumption for the whole processing line. So so this is the red gram we have subjected for the same treatment like hydrothermal treatments. So we had got a more number of gota or the whole grains, dehusked whole grains. So why we want to concentrate on the dehusked whole grains means inside the slit drains there is a germ tip which is more proteinaceous and more of an gives an protein value to the pulses. So we want to get more of a dehusked whole grains, and if you go for the pitting, there is certain damages happen in the surface of the on the surface of the grains, which is called as like kibbling. They call it in the commercial term, they call it kibbling. And when you go for a little bit of polishing, the surface, the main pulse milling is mainly that the surface of the grains are coated with more of protein concentrate. So if you go for number of times of polishing, you will lose the protein. Only that protein will be concentrating on this powder and then broken bits, not on the grains for the circuit. So that we have to be careful when we are polishing the grains. Too much of polishing is not advisable for the pulses. So here we have also the same thing for the black gram. So black gram, when it is subject for pitting and then for the polishing, and we are getting a lot of powder and husk. So this is a very critical grain where we have to give a little bit of heat. When you subject the grains for more heating, it will lose its properties of batter forming. Mainly this black gram is subjected for idli making, fermented foods. So anything we have to be very careful on this black gram treatment. So one of the studies which we have done is that if the temperature is less than 60 degrees, the grain temperature is heated for the condition for less than 60 degrees, the batter volume is good, batter forming quality is good. If suppose if it is going beyond that 60 degree up to 90 degrees, that batter quality is reduced. So and then oil requirement is also, we need only 0.2% of oil requirement for after pitting for the grains, black gram. So if you see this batter volume, you can see that it's uniformly at 0 hours, all this black gram were ground, wet grinded, and then put it in the thing. And if you see this, with the increase in the temperature, say this is around 40 degrees, but when it is subjected to 90 degrees, the batter volume is reduced. So this will also indirectly affect the price. For example, if you are making a vada out of this batter, idli batter, this black gram batter, the number of vada will be lesser. So that commercially you are losing the value, or the quality also goes down. So we have to be very careful in preparing the black gram, de-husking the black gram with the temperature profile. So next is we are looking for the different grains like Bengal gram and whole grains. So Bengal gram is the major crop which is grown all over India, and then this is a major rain fed crop in Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra and UP, all these areas. So these grains have a very excellent quality of protein and easy to cook, and number of snack foods are used, a number of snack foods are prepared out of this. So apart from that, if you see the milling industries, the byproducts, If you see rice milling and the pulse milling are the major agro industries in India, and the byproducts which are coming out of that are brokens, rice brokens, and the pulse milling husk and powder. So these two can be made different products, ready to eat products from different areas. So we have tried with the different value added products from the pulses. So whole pulses we can make a lot of value added products, and then split pulses like papas, noodles, and pasta products, and chapatis and flour. So after that, fractionation, different fractions are there. We can use the husk and other things for different value added products. The flour making is a typical thing where the flour should be ground in such a way that the particle size is also a finest one, and then too much of heating should not be happening when we are making the flour. So that if overheating is there, the protein degrades, and then the quality of the end product will be affected. You cannot subject for different products like pasta or puppets, so that it gets darkened. And in the biscuits and other things, the fractions like husk and other bits can be used for the bakery industries. So some of the products, value added products, I'm just showing you for the interest. So extrusion cooking, this is the lentils and peas can be made into pasta products like this one, which can be combined with the rice to improve the lysine content and the methionine content. And this is the rice brokens and pulse mill brokens are made together, and ready to eat products can be used for the single screw extruders. And these are the bakery products. So here also we have to be very careful when we are making the flour and the germination. If the pulses are germinated, it have a very good quality of making other value added products, and it can also be subject for minimum temperature baking, so that there is no need for higher temperature things. So ready to eat snack foods and ada mixes can be developed using the chickpea, and quick cooking chickpea also has been developed in our institute. So only thing is that we have to soak it, grade it, and then dehydrate it in a proper manner, and we can rehydrate it when we are using for different end users, ready to eat products and sambar and idli mixes. So these are the pasta products. So mainly the pulses have a low gluten. So low gluten means it is having a very high end quality proteins, and then can be used for many of the western products like pasta, macaroni, or shells like that. So these are the products which can be developed using pulses, pulse flour like black gram and green gram and Bengal gram. And these are nutri pellets. Nutri pellets can be developed using pulses, and this can also be used for mung bean. Mung bean is used as a fried item, a snack food. So along with this slight frying, using in a little bit of a higher temperature, and you can puff it, the puffed grains along with the chocolates and other things, you can make it as a chocolate mahua bar. Mahua is the plant which is available in Bihar and Chhattisgarh, other areas, which is used for making alcoholic drink. But instead of that, we can use this mahua flour for making a nutritious nutri bars or chocolates. And Bengal gram products, a lot of Bengal gram products are there. But all the Bengal gram products which we have to make, it only major concentration we have to have is on the flour making and particle size analysis, and what type of flour we can make. There are a lot of size reduction equipments are there, like hammer mill and burr mill, and there are now cryogenic grinders have come. So these cryogenic grinders are having a high potential usage. We can use it. Many of the products can be developed with more easy, not degrading too much of the nutrient in it. And say minor pulses like horse gram soup and many other products can be developed using the horse gram. And here the malting, major consumption in all the major restaurants or in household level we are using sprouting as a technique for consuming directly the sun, especially the green gram sprout and Bengal gram sprout are many having a lot of applications and easy to make it in the home level. So this sprouted grains are having a very good industrial application. Say for example, we have done with the sprouted, and the sprouted grains are made into flour with the lower temperature grinder and then flaked and then extruded and flaked into a ready-to-eat flakes. Like you can, this is an ingredient type. This is an ingredient and this is the end product. So you can change that end product, or you can change, you come combine this sprouted flour with the different ingredients to make as a ready-to-drink or ready-to-eat products. And this itself is a big business opportunity for the people. So if you see that, what are the changes happening in different drying systems of the green gram sprouts? So if you see when you are the green gram is sprouted, it has to be dried to a safer moisture level. When it is dried with a radio frequency dryer, where the amylase, where different treatments we have subjected for amylase and control green gram, that the biological value and the nitrogen index are very excellent compared to the normal control samples. So these are the products which we are able to make. This is the status of pulse milling industries where they handle the things. So we want to carefully handle these materials and then grade it and then classify the materials, and we can use it for different end uses. These are the simplest things. Bakery products and extruded products can be done using the milling byproducts alone. So mill, the whole grains and split grains are used for the cooking. Apart from that, this can also. So if you see that there is an 100% opportunity for the usage of all the pulse milling products. So another product what we have done use with the late high end thing is that extrusion cooking, where the rice brokens and pulse powder are made together and then mixed in certain proportions, reorienting into a grain analogs. So the first thing is that it is all single screw extruder using the, these are all ready to cook type of thing, and these are all ready to eat type of products. So if you use a single screw extruder, you can make it as a pellets, and these pellets can be made into different ready to cook products, or you can use it as a similar to that of a pulse. In this one, we can make whatever the desired components or the nutrient added to it, we can make it. So another thing is this is the second line. This one is ready to eat products. So like without oil or snacks, low oil, high protein, and low carbohydrate, and more fibrous material are there. So this can be consumed as a ready to eat products. So the cost of it, this initial investment is a little bit higher, but still it is worth for an export oriented opportunities. And nowadays that is more towards the smart protein. So the proteins that is isolated in this components are used for the mimicking the meat. So we are also coming up with some of the products on this smart protein segments, and we have also done with a lot of work with the grains using as a smart protein, like a vegan meat. So there's an opportunity, an excellent opportunity for the industries to develop, and more explore, more products can be explored in this pulse industries. So thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you so much, sir. Moving ahead with the next technical talk, may I invite Shri G. Thirumurugan, State President, Tamil Nadu Appalam Vadagam Moorvathil Sangam Madurai, for sharing success story of pulse paper making industry. We welcome you, sir. The session is over to you.
Manakkam, Thirumurugan. Mudhala vandhu na nandri solvathu vandhu nama director திரு ஆனந்தராமன் அவர்களுக்கு தான். ஏன்னா நாங்கள் குறிய வட்டத்தில் இருந்தவங்கள உன்னை அடுத்த கட்டத்துக்கு வாங்க அப்படின்ற ஒரு இதை வந்து எனக்கு மோட்டிவேட்டிவ் பண்ணது அவர் தான். ஏன்னா எடுத்தோடனே வந்து எனக்கு அப்பாயின்மெண்ட் கொடுத்து உடனே வாங்க அப்படின்னு சொல்லி இது பண்ண அவருக்கும், அதுக்கு முன்னாடி இருந்து நமது ஜெகமோன் சார். அதுக்கு முன்னாடியே 10 வருஷத்துக்கு முன்னாடி இருந்தே என்னை ஃபாலோ பண்ணி அப்பளத்துக்கு இந்த மாதிரி பண்ணுங்க, இந்த மாதிரி பண்ணுங்க, அடுத்த ஸ்டேஜுக்கு வாங்க. ஏன்னா நாங்கள் சிறு சிறு குறுந்தொழில்கள் உள்ளவங்க, வீட்டிலேயே தயார் பண்ணி வீட்டிலேயே இது பண்ணி அப்படியே விற்கிறவங்களை ஒரு அடுத்த லெவலுக்கு கார்பரேட் லெவலுக்கு இப்போ வளர்ந்துக்கிறோம்னா அது முக்கியமாக தஞ்சாவூருடைய ஐஏஎஃப்டியோட தான் காரணம் என்று முதல்ல தெரிஞ்சுக்கிறேன். அது ஜெகன்மோகன் சாருக்கு மிக்க நன்றி. அனந்தனம் சார் வந்து அடுத்த லெவலுக்கு நீங்க வாங்க அப்படின்னு சொல்லிட்டு சில பேர்லாம் என்ன நினைப்பாங்க, சரி ரைட்டு ஒரு வாரம் பார்ப்போம், 10 நாள் பார்ப்போம், அப்புறம் சொல்றேன்னு சொல்லுவாங்க. ஆனா உடனடியாக ஒரு டீமை உருவாக்கி நமது வெங்கடாஜலபதி சாரும் ஜெகன்மோகன் சாரோட ஒரு டீமை உருவாக்கி எங்க தொழிலுக்கு என்னென்ன லேட்டஸ்ட் டெக்னாலஜி கொண்டு வரணும் அப்படின்றத முடிவு பண்ணி உடனே அடுத்த வாரமே வந்து இந்த மதுரையில வந்து விசிட் பண்ணி இருந்தாங்க. அதாவது அப்பளம் அப்பளம் தானே அப்படின்னு எடுப்பாங்க, ஆனா அப்பளம் வந்து ஒரு வருஷத்துக்கு எவ்வளவு ஏற்றுமதி ஆகுது அப்படின்றத வந்து இந்த தருணத்துல வந்து நான் தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கிறேன். குறிப்பா வந்து ஏற்றுமதி வந்து 426 கோடி ரூபாய் பெருமானம் உள்ள அப்பளங்கள் வந்து எக்ஸ்போர்ட் ஆகுது. இன்னொன்னு நினைச்சீங்கன்னா 2009-2010 வந்து ஒரு 116 கோடி ரூபாய் தான் எக்ஸ்போர்ட் ஆனது. ஆனா இப்ப பாருங்க, இதை பாத்தீங்கன்னா இப்ப 416 கோடி ரூபாய் பெருமானம் உள்ள அப்பளம் வந்து எக்ஸ்போர்ட் ஆகிட்டு இருக்கு. அப்ப எவ்வளவு பாருங்க, இந்த 10 வருஷத்துக்குள்ள எவ்வளவு இம்ப்ரூவ்மெண்ட் ஆயிருக்குன்றத நீங்க இது பண்ணணும். மேற்கொண்டு எனது பிரதர் வந்து இப்ப உரையாற்றுவார், மிஸ்டர் சந்துரு.
Yeah, good afternoon to all. Appalam manufacturing is a cottages industry, and on behalf of Appalam Madagam Moorvathal Sang Manufacturers and Sellers Associations, AVM Associations, it's pleasure to give the presentations about Papad, means Appalam Industries. It's mainly made up of urathal, it's from the pulses, which is rich in protein. So as you all aware, and the introductions, well, talking about the introductions of Appalam, the journey of our Appalam started 3 to 4 decades back, almost 3-4 decades back. The peoples who learned the papad from the manufacturing of papadam, that's our second point, is the Appalam emerged from the base of papadam, which is from the Kerala. So the people from Tamil Nadu, they learn the papadam from Kerala, process from Kerala. The product papadam have very less shelf life, and now we increase the shelf life by drying it in the sunlight, means with very less moisture, and it was improved, and it was introduced in Tamil Nadu 3-4 decades back. And the ancestors, they worked a lot to market these papads. And as I said, the family members, they started manufacturing this. They started as a family business, and as a cottages industries based in Madurai. They learned these papadam industries, and after drying this. It was taken to the markets everywhere. They had taken to the markets, and they fried in front of people, and they introduced this, and they had worked a lot 4 decades back actually. So the manufacturers at present, we are doing this continuously for the decades now, and we are 3-4 decades we are doing it the business now. And the main ingredient for the Appalam is urad dal. Means urad dal flour, which we are milling, almost 88-90% of pure urad dal actually. That's the main ingredient we are using. And this rice flour, when we talk about this rice flour, we are using this rice flour only for dusting, just to avoid the stickiness, because that urad dal mainly, urad dal have a, it will always stick on to there, right? So to avoid that stickiness, we are using this rice flour for dusting, and the salt and sodium bicarbonate, calcium bicarbonate, In southern regions of Tamil Nadu, we use sodium bicarbonate as the ingredient, and few parts of Kanchipuram, Chennai, the northern part of Tamil Nadu, they use calcium bicarbonate. So these are the two ingredients which are, no, that's the only difference from southern region and northern regions actually. And edible vegetable oil, this is also for avoid the stickiness. After making the dough, to avoid stickiness, we are using this edible vegetable oil. And spices, these spices are optional, based on, because majorly we will make a plain papadam. Otherwise, you know, in case of any special product, if any order, then we will use the spices like pepper, cumin, any kind of spices. That's totally optional actually. And these are the flowchart for the papadam manufacturing. We'll mix water with salt and sodium bicarbonate and asafoetida. This salt, sodium bicarbonate, asafoetida will all three will get mixed in the water, and this water we'll use it for dough making. We don't use salt or sodium bicarbonate directly in the flour. So this will be dissolved in the water, and this water will be used for dough making. So this orit dal will be milled to a flour, and this flour we'll put it in a grinder. This grinder, you know, this is a dough maker actually, dough maker. So we'll add this flour and this water. We'll get a dough. This dough will be again, you know, will be seated in a seating machine. We do have a seating machine, and after seating machine, we'll make get a exact size of papad, and it will be sun-dried. So you know, it will be sun-dried, and before the sun-dried, the main part is, you know, appalam collected, and it will be stored wet. This is a kind of fermentation process. It will be dried direct in the sunlight, and you know, after drying, it is actually 3 days of process. You know, once if we make a dough today, we'll make a papad in a first day, and the second day it will be second dry. Third day it will be blow it. I don't know. We'll blow it and we'll remove that excess rice flour which is sticking on the papad, and after that. It is optional, you know, based on the manufacturers or based on the styles. If required, we'll go for a fumigation, or we'll directly pack it. This fumigation, you know, is mainly for you know, increase the shelf life of appalam. So that, you know, that's the only way we are using to increase the shelf life at present. And these are the product data oxides. So, you know, when we discuss about this appalam, it is dry product measured by the weight, and when we talk about that moisture, it will be actual standard. It should not be more than 14, but usually we'll maintain it that at the level of 10.5, maximum 11. So this is the level we are maintaining at present. And storage conditions, you know, the storage conditions, it should be stored in a food grade tubs. And, you know, usually I said it, right? Because, you know, based on the styles of manufacturing, it will be stored in a great plastic tubs, and it will be fumigated so that we'll get the good shelf life. Maybe up to 12 months from the manufacturing. And introduces potential abuse. For general public consumption, and it will be packed in retail packs and the tight containers. It will be packed and it will be transit in transits. Details on packaging, it will be packed in a paper wrapper as well as in a poly wrapper. The varieties of appalam, when we talk about the varieties, there are many varieties. The plain appalam, which is made up of pure orit dal, no any spices or any condiments mixed, and cumin appalam, which is a mixture of cumin. Masala appalam, which is the mixture of pepper and ajwan, and pepper appalam is a mixture of only pepper, black pepper or white pepper based on the customer's requirement, and chili papad. You know, chili appalam is it's a mixture of red chili papad. Ring appalam, it is a traditional method. The children will enjoy it. And the sobi appalam is also a traditional method, and this poin and disco papad, these are the recently we are introduced after when it was mechanized. So these are the varieties of appalam, and varieties, there is also one more varieties which is based on the sizes, because there are 5-6 different sizes of papadam, papalams are there. The rest of the things, you know, this oval, ring apalam, the picture, you know, the third picture, that is what we used to say is the ring apalam. You know, we can, you know, the people, the children, they used to, wear it in their figure and they'll enjoy it. So these are the varieties of apalam, and there is varieties in sizes too. So this is the major. And when we talk about that laborers employed, there is almost 70,000 plus laborers are engaged in Madurai, in Madurai region alone, and more than 3 lakh laborers throughout the Tamil Nadu. So Tamil Nadu in that sense, you know, the region from Coimbatore, Tiruchi, there are manufacturing units in Coimbatore, Tiruchi, and as I said, in Kanchipuram and Chennai. These are the places where other manufacturers are engaged. In that volume, among the 80% of the laborers are women. Which means it is totally women empowered industries actually. So we are giving opportunities for the women, and a lot of women widower kind of laborers are engaged. So this is purely women oriented, like women oriented industries actually. And manufacturers engaged. When we talk about the manufacturers in a field, there are almost 500 plus of manufacturers and sellers are there in Madurai region alone. And 24 numbers of manufacturers and sellers are there in Trichy. 46 manufacturers and sellers are there in Coimbatore, and only 36 plus manufacturers and sellers throughout the Chennai and Kanchipuram region actually. This is. So these are the registered people. Actually, the people, those who register with our associations. Only the person, those who engage with the association, will be considered as the stressful manufacturers and sellers in a market actually. So these are the manufacturers, those who engage with us actually. And the production, when we talk about the production and sales per annum, almost 500 plus tons are producing in the Madurai region. And Madurai region, I said you read 500 plus members, 750 plus members are there in Madurai alone. So 500 plus tons are manufacturing in Madurai, and 1000 plus tons per month throughout the Tamil Nadu. So Madurai plays a major role in manufacturing and sales actually. And you know, when we talk about the sales, there are almost 1200 crores of sales is there at present, which includes domestic sales for the apalam manufacturing. And this is for domestic productions. And when we talk about the export sales, there is almost, we had a turnover of 145 crores of exports for the financial year 2009 and 10. And now we have achieved the turnover of rupees 402 crores for the financial year of 2020-21, which is 93.96% of growth over the 10 years. So we had not only the volume, value, we also increased, the volume also increased. So we are encouraging our manufacturers for the export sales. And even the governments, we are using the government schemes and for the sales improvements now. And there are 1162 active manufacturers and traders are engaged in apalam apalam exports. This is the data throughout the India actually. This is 1162. Not only the manufacturer, the merchant traders are also engaged in the exports. Now, from the association, we are encouraging our manufacturers for the direct export. So these are the steps we are taking from the association at present. So these are our major buying countries. In that, we used to export a lot of volume to Sri Lanka market, but unfortunately, for the past 2 years, due to government policies and the things, the Sri Lanka, they had restricted the import of apalam. So we have lost our export sales to the Sri Lankan country. So this affects the manufacturers a lot. And when we talk about the major buying countries, almost 34% of the stacks in those to UK market, where they are buying almost 178.9 crores value of goods. And secondly, United States, which is 56.6 crores. Australia, they are buying almost 38.9 crores value goods. And Canada, 22.6. These four markets, you know, they are buying only the calcium bicarbonate copper, and the rest of the people, you know, the rest of the countries, start from UAE to other countries, you know, they'll buy, mostly they'll buy only sodium bicarbonate copper from the southern part of Tamil Nadu actually. So UAE, they are buying 22.1 crore, Malaysia takes the fifth position, I think, they're buying for almost of 20.8 crores. Nepal, Bangladesh, Saudi Arabia. So these countries, you know, these are the major buying countries for the apple and copper. Yes. Yeah. And this, when we talk about milestone, see, from our AVN association, this is our success milestone. You know, we already initiated the process of cluster formations. We almost 25 major members. We already initiated the process of that. You know, we already started the process, and it is in a line, in a beginning stage. So soon we'll finish all this success with your with your all great support. And these are our core team members for the cluster actually. The president is Thirumugan, he's with me, and the vice chairman is Mr. Manikandan, managing director is CGVGs, and the other managing directors are Marimuthu, Vijayan, JK Muthu is our advisor, and our coordinators are Palani Kumar and Nagaraj. And when we talk about the timeline, in the 1998 we started our associations for the welfare of manufacturers associations. This is based in Madurai, which is Appalam Manufacturers Welfare Association, which was started successfully, and with the help of association, we had the problems of our traders and the manufacturers was solved. And later, this association, in the year of 2012. The Vadagam manufacturers and more metal manufacturers, they had syndicated with our manufacturing association, and they are named as AVM association in the year 2012. In the year 2013, the other manufacturers, you know, from the other regions like Chennai, Trichy, Coimbatore, they had also joined their hands with our association, and we had developed to a Tamil Nadu Appalam More Metal and Vadagam associations. And it was led by our president, Mr. Thirumurgan. Due to his dynamic, active, everything happens. And only because of him, in this regard, we are joining with Nifty. Thanks for giving us the opportunity to present about our Appalam products in a national way.
We will play one video on the processing of puppet making. I hope this video will be useful for all of us.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing those informative sessions with us.